So thanks for tuning in. This is Rayn Gryphon, and I'm reporting from Vancouver Island, which is on the west coast of Canada, and it's a very charitable place in the world to live, very temperate in every way. We have a pretty good access to healthcare, as dangerous as that often is in the best of circumstances. Pretty good access to education, as dangerous as that is in most circumstances. Pretty good access to clean food and water, as dangerous as that is in some of what are considered the best of circumstances. And this is early summer. Got some variable cloud and sun, and I'm sitting under a tree, acutely aware of my diminutive place among the throngs of human existence and creativity. And I'm going to preface what will be the reading of some philosophy, some poetry, and some very pointed remarks about the kinds of religious, dangerously, if customary religious dimensions to politics, to life as a whole, how we come to think that we're thinking independently and making very autonomous decisions. With acute distinctions between our most primal reflexes and objective determinations that, you know, make adequate provision for our freedom of personal revelation, personal intuition. And that threshold between personal revelation and objective truth, what we feel our burden is when we claim that one is the other, is a terrain, I think, in which all human blood and all unnecessary human injury exists, is excused, is glorified, is protected, and is indulged by people of any and all distinctions and professions and faiths and creeds over all space and time. Now, I write poetry. I guess I should say I am a poet. But I want to be clear when you listen to this that poetry, similar to just any other way that we occupy ourselves, for or not for money, for instance, whether you're a bricklayer or an accountant, right, you have the right to feel that what you're doing is valuable and to consider it intrinsically valuable to all life. But that doesn't mean that as poetic or as philosophical as the following things may sound, that you have to find them value or that you valuable, or that you have to agree that they're intrinsically valuable to the world. I only ask that if you don't like something, consider the value in trying to discover why you don't like it and expressing why you don't like it for your own sake, right? Because I don't know much about the world. There's not much that I can say I know for sure. It's a very complicated world. But nor does that mean that I shouldn't attempt to describe accurately the landscape that we live in, the psychological landscape we live in. And nor does anyone, I think, have a monopoly on what the world is or why it is the way it is. What man was or might have been, what man is or could be, and what man may be or should be in the future. And that's part of that terrain between personal revelation and its value and objective truth, and what we do or do not do to support the equation of the two, the blurring of the edges of both of them, which is natural to some degree, that admits a wide range of imagination and speculation and knowledge claims, far beyond what I think we often actually can say we know, but also admits a dangerous manipulation. It can make people fall back on reflexes that are far more dangerous than they are subsequently at leave to consider, even when prompted to do so. So, without any further introduction, I will then begin to read. And this became a two or three series of sort of poetic dissertations on my blog at cosmicheaven.blogspot.ca. Again, this is Rayn Gryphon, and sit back, enjoy. This is not a canon, this is not a catechism, this is simply one human being among the huge throng of human beings making an attempt, offering some anspit in the great torrents of human and cosmic thought in which or with which we are involved and is involved in us on the daily basis, each in our own most personal terms. So, there is so much more going on in the world that most are thus disposed to even consider, and even less so how much it preys upon and relies upon the very nature of our own individual heart and mind, and indeed all of the geographically specific streams of cosmological, human, family heritage, traditions, and symbolic systems of life, growth, transformation, and posterity. There is so much more going on in the world than most are thus disposed to even consider, and even less so how much it preys upon and relies upon the very nature of our own individual heart and mind, and indeed all of the geographically specific streams of cosmological, human, family heritage, traditions, and symbolic systems of life, growth, transformation, and posterity. The alphabet of how we articulate our life through all of our psychological, biological, and social limbs and instruments. Suffice it to say that generations from now, and even now, people will remember Bill Clinton or George W. Bush as, quote, presidents of the United States. That will command, as does, a great value to the people who enjoy a pastoral and patriotic sense of nation and democracy, of liberty at its best, staving off the manifold horrors of historical inequities so astronomical as to render rather diminutive, by dwarfing like some august chapel of the Renaissance or Middle Ages, the comparatively acceptable inequities and superstitions of the so-called modern era. But this is patently untrue, and would remain a viable folk religion or story were it not for the fact that its primary conceit were its equivalence, on pain of ridicule, to an actual locus of an actual psychosocial sequence of progressively more exceptional, if imperfect, events on the part of these presidential icons and all that over which their holy image presides or prevails among however conflicting points of view in an otherwise free democracy. These and all such icons are installed not just to a political office, but to a much ingrained, codified, and canonical pageant, or narcotic subterfuge, a kind of holy regency, wherein one is asked by any and all to enter into a kind of suspension of disbelief as to the relatively non-existent good or value of one's vote or ballot of confidence or lack thereof, one's candidates only ever sustaining the most mock, if convincing, compliance with or investigation by the laws one is as duped into presuming rule over even they who propose to rule over oneself and by and large over the intervening space of the amniotic fluid and symbolic matrix of all that we laughingly presume to be our commensurate human cognitive, biological, and psychological agency. Farcical as it is, such streams of history eclipse like oncoming lights the reflexes of a catatonic deer caught in the proverbial headlights, the actual pains and thus mitigating influence of the actual family history, of the actual biological and psychological contortions and injuries to the crucible of the family unit that would alert us to some more sober kind of social responsibility. And all of this can be traced, as to its cause or effect, to the kinds and scales of psychological, as pecuniary, economic, and psychological debt heaped upon our vulnerable children and indeed their prospective brain development by every religious and political church in the world. And as with Christianity, this debt, and I've known sociopaths, right, and they sort of prey upon throwing people off balance by accusing them of things, and most people, you know, will stop to think about whether they're guilty when they're accused of things, and thereby extract energy, compliance, and consent into their very aggressive ideas about what other people should do for them, or what they haven't done for them, what they should do for them. In the case of Christianity, one is indoctrinated into a kind of assumption that one is born with some kind of debt, and that if you don't deal with that, and you can't by yourself, then you'll be sent to some kind of debtor's prison called hell. And it's made it even more alluring because the solution, the debt, has already been paid by God or Jesus. And so you're left really just with the tantalizing, if daunting, idea that you merely need to accept this payment, even though it's all very obscure about how this payment is transferred to you or on your behalf. And then, of course, you'll get out of debt. This is all going on in a very fantastical world. But it's a good way to look at, religious or not, the Christian, or the similarly kind of Christian aspects of the culture of Christianity, just like Islam has a culture and a religion. And so much debt is heaped upon people. People are forced to contend with the idea of paying their way for some kind of obscure burden that they've placed in the world just by being born into it, which is a complete reversal of the kind of economy and psychology of life and growth, and indeed the peculiar relationships shared by mothers and fathers and children in the great enterprise of a life that is full of enormous wealth and has conferred human beings with the ability to produce and transform enormous kinds of wealth that are never adequately reported by the economic priests of most respective societies throughout the world. In this way, so much, by throwing them off balance and getting them to throw each other and their own children off balance, is extracted from them and the earth, as though there's never enough, and we are never enough. So, to be fair, I mean, you could argue that such are the logistics of a civilization and so forth, but that doesn't mean that it's a nice thing. There is so much more going on in the world than most are thus disposed to even consider, and even less so how much it preys upon and relies upon the very nature of our own individual heart and mind, and indeed all of the geographically specific streams of cosmological human family heritage traditions and symbolic systems of life, growth, transformation, and posterity. For instance, President Barack Obama received a, quote, Nobel Peace Prize on the heels of a famous speech declaring that he and America would commence a vast reduction of their nuclear arsenal. What was not reported was that upon receiving this prize and making this speech, he and America vastly increased and accelerated nuclear weapon proliferation. So if you're thrown off balance, that the Christian salvation is predicated upon convincing you that you have some debt. And most people feel, because of the pains of living or the pains induced by society, guilt is a natural component of acute stress or developmental injury. And so different forms of marketing, religion is just one kind of corporation, and there are many different brands in the Christian religion, preys upon stimulating this guilt, and indeed those who would do so feel that this is exactly how life should be. They're convinced that the equation of the injury-related guilt that they suffer is something that they were born with, and and holds out the prospect of some eternal heaven and some eternal hell, notwithstanding the fact that this generally creates heavens and hells on earth that are virtually interchangeable depending upon where you happen to stand in the great celestial casino of every intersecting corporate fiction in the world. Victim, prey, predator, and so forth. So let's move on. The whole psychology of life is the whole psychology of man. To disrespect one is to disrespect both. This remains the effectively primary purpose of science, medicine, religion, and spirituality. Now, following is a related dissertation called A Modest Proposal, sort of faintly referencing something written by Jonathan Swift in poverty-stricken old England. He proposed a resolution to famine as eating children in order to cast a kind of satirical slant upon the inhuman policies of the government of the time that was inducing a lot more suffering than need be. But human sacrifice is a very real thing. Human beings enduring more and more stress and having their consequent guilt, which is a medical symptom of stress, preyed upon by forms of salvation, progress, success, innovation that then induce far more stress than need be, and not the least being that which is inevitable when you forfeit even more of your critical faculties pursuant to getting some kind of relief to more suffering than you can even conceive of, having been long been induced upon you. Indeed, this is projected out onto cosmological, godlike, satanic-like sort of existential quests for debt remedy and personal resolution. So the entire universe of the mind is contorted when we subject one another to undue stress. So the first stage, of course, is sober reflection and assessment of what's going on. And this in itself is a fairly daunting task. Difficult, so difficult that its very difficulty, if you'll listen to people, is often used as an excuse never to engage upon it in exchange for other forms of fantastical journeys of salvation and sanity. However, inevitable, the suffering that this confers upon everyone. This is part of the narcotic or drug-like psychology of all of the religious trappings of taxation and science and modern existence. Not to say that it's all bad, but nor should we prohibit looking at its actual costs, something that's very hard for people to do at the best of times. Here is a modest proposal. I spoke to a man the other day who had gone on a number throughout his life of drug-induced vision quests. It's really important to note that the sheer number of such chemically induced visions that he has embarked upon have left him with unmistakable symptoms of mental degradation. But I think it would be foolish of me to discount the kinds of stories that he shared with me, many of which have found themselves inspiring, or at least stimulating, some of my own long-held suspicions, at least for one kind of construct, as to the cosmological psychology. God has a psychology, we have a psychology, and at the very least, God could be seen to have a value by his or her mere existence, augmenting the difficult, if joyful, and ambitious, and wonderful task of conceiving of a whole psychology for ourselves that can have some, I think, due relationship or correspondence with the physical vagaries of our lives. And indeed, I think, a level of an invisible realms that I think we have to have some kind of open-mindedness to. Just saying the world is empirically an amount of discrete forces that can be understood by mathematics and that this is all that the mind really adds up to is to put as much of a lid upon, I think, the untold capacities of human psychological agency as would, you know, the most ambitious science fiction stories of the New Age and religion the world over, which really aren't as liberal as they are, as expansive as they often claim to be, predicated as they are upon forfeiting even more of your faculties, pursuant to equating however personal and valuable revelations with some objective reality, and then coercing people into accepting it and transmitting it like a venereal disease, on pain of saying that somebody isn't spiritual, they're not in the heart, they're not enlightened, they're asleep, and all these kinds of things. These are not polite kinds of interaction. But spirituality and religion is not polite, and its coercive pretensions are predicated on those people having sustained significant injury to their native psychological sovereignty. So we begin thus. Here is a story of human psychology. And so a psychological story and a story of a kind of psychology, of the birth and nature of a mind that permeates, sustains, and unfolds according to each person, peculiar to every member of life and cosmos as a whole, in every heart, a pulse in every dark, every shade and nature of literal and figurative illumination, and indeed the sequential concentric development of a level of inward and outward fulfillment that is and is forever expanding in terms of ourselves and everyone and everything else here and hereafter, as a fundamental reality or alchemy of transformation and continuity of the sovereign nature of human thought, feeling, and responsibility, of scintillating letters, ethers, notes, and codes of human creativity, and that of the wonder, the substance, and the mother of the cosmos itself. The story starts with a paradox, that of an unmanifest or unborn, but not non-existent field of infinite creative being and potential, of energy and intelligence, creation and destruction, of life as it is or may have been or may ever be, each in our own unique ways of knowing and growing with life, each as valuable to the whole of life here and hereafter, as an inextricable facet of the very birth and purpose of all life on every plane of being simultaneously, in endless reciprocal correspondence, though as mother to child, season and star, body, mind, and heart, to every legacy and memory of every leaf and seed and bird, and they to us. The field, this field of infinite potential or unseen light, decides or is inspired or both to give birth to visible light, the visible or manifest light of infinite potential, the very first man, Adam or Lucifer, God, Venus, Saturn, the original androgen, suspended in and animated by the amniotic impulse and agency of activity and psychology of cosmos. The activity and psychology of cosmos, of every potential congruence, integration, separation, conflict, creativity, bereavement and joy of all experience and activity, natural, human, and celestial. He and his mother, father, and great mother, void, since imagined in vision and dream as a beautiful and supple black Madonna at the locus of all history, geometry, alphabets, science, religion, psychology, peace and depravity, awareness and sublimation, memory and forgetfulness, every transformation, change, growth, and every nature, organ, and purpose of every age, stage, plane, organ, body, and sensibility of life, in whom and by each all were encompassed and comprehended, the living impulse, a grace, a forgiveness, a charity, kindness, love, sexuality, and humanity, a reciprocal, cellular as social, individual as angelic correspondence of the sequential unfolding of all mind and matter, desire, sense, and sensibility, hope, loss, grief, and dream, loss and continuity, within and beyond all description, a kind of Christ archetype, lending itself or himself as principle and person to endless collaboration, novelty, and improvisation, bound up with the precise and resounding sequence of events of mind and cosmos, only just about to unfold and forever unfolding, and though only just about to commence, are only just begun from once upon a time, from the great mother, our terrestrial and celestial genetic fountainhead, forever under the impulse of your own mother and father, under the impulse of your own birth and life, desire and thought, and these every wind, every scintillating reach, letter, orbit, depth, meaning and breadth of sun, moon, and shade, and clay that animated with and by the boundless fulfillment of all that has ever or will be said or known or felt, suffered, lost, and won, remembered and forgotten, every aesthetic and cell of communication, regeneration, degradation, and commemoration across all bounds of space, time, and mind, yours and mine, theirs and ours, hers and his, that and this. And as it, or she, does so, there is realized by his or her descendants and heirs, sons and daughters, the individual sensibility and inheritance of a history, a persistent concussion in blood and bone, feeling and thought, memory and destiny, man and nature, winter and spring, dusk and dawn, as of the slow breaking of an eternal union and embrace by all that is man and all that is woman. A divine embrace and indeed a divine separation or movement apart upon conception of the manifest and manifold light and child of infinite life and bliss, of infinite creative intelligence and correspondence. As we type and read, as we listen these words, there is felt. Still, the impulse of a story suffers and enjoys boundless interpretation, creation and embellishment, though growing, eminently or from within its protracted spates of dormancy, with every turn of thought or word, growing for and through ourselves and everyone else forever, the illimitable substance of forever, forever passing by for the purpose, tempered by our choices and experiences, our aptitudes and inclinations, of expanding our capacity for a paradoxically living and unfolding fullness of creation, though at the first separation, upon distillation of the fullness of infinite living potential, unmanifest light or spirit, or born all subsequent life and to death, separation from life for and against all life, every rhythm of thought, sense, memory, hope, and experience that would ever know and know the inspiration or ache of cosmic and personal history as it is both inherited and improvised by its every heir. As the first child grew with his first burgeoning experience of individuation from his holy mother and father, virtually indistinguishable as they were or are from the great womb, the great void, the first black mother and virgin holy night, or unmanifest light, and himself, they from each other, so did he experience an unexpected wonder and shudder of fear that passed through waves across all manifest existence. To thine own self be true. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one can come to the Father, the Mother, really, but by me. The nature, extent, and extent of this fear, even subtle but profound psychosis, this first sin or pain and pleasure, this moment of doubt as to his connection to infinite potential, and loving kindness filled the pungent flower of all flowers, the rose of all roses, all blood and water, earth and air, light and dark, the first intervening and growing space of time between the Holy Mother and Holy Father and they, the great black void of virgin night, were to be a matter of continued speculation, as it must, given the mind it was and gave birth to, or whose birth or nature it was an artifact of. This fear were part of the nature and artifact of a sublimation of infinite creative potential or intelligence. All that one is and is come from, and why this soul from that soul, this self from that self, the mind that formed the medium for all memory and causation, all agency or activity, human and divine. The mind today were still an artifact and nature of first and lasting sublimation of boundless creative potential and understanding, loving kindness. This has since been perverted and misunderstood as a fall and as original sin or bad karma, a shadow in or of the ego, ignorance or suffering beset desire, as though this personal sense of self should not exist at all. Truly, though, the existence of the personal self were predicated upon sublimation, a little death and maybe the only one, of the boundless selfhood of infinite potential and its maternity and paternity. Therein lay the very purpose, inspiration, and inheritance and nature of itself. Quoting, where lies the final harbor? Whence we unmoor no more? In what rapt ether sails the world, of which the weariest will never weary? Where is the foundling's father hidden? Our souls are like those orphans whose unwedded mothers die in bearing them. The secret of our paternity lies in their grave, and we must there learn it. Herman Melville in Moby Dick. To each human, a little doubt must fall. So it has come down to us the paradox or irony that all that so many billions of human beings think they suffer from most is that which goes to the very wholeness that we both know and seek. So nihilism, self-denial, natural as it is to a mind that has sustained disproportionate stress and violence that is often not considered violence by most ostensibly well-educated or modern people. So nihilism is not the cure, but it's natural. And nihilism can be so essential to mitigating for brain trauma that it becomes extolled by the surviving intelligence and immunity and even cellular immunology of social groups under whatever spiritual, religious, economic, or scientific pretense, medical. It becomes customary. And then it comes with a compulsion to transmit itself to others, though one's whole safety and that of others were totally predicated upon it. And this is a very serious issue. There is always, though, a response in nature and in people to honor one's personal sense of self, as diminutive as it is, as kind of isolated it may seem to be, from the wholeness in life or primordial intelligence from which it springs. So we can go within, we say, we can dissolve the ego, I don't think that's sensible, or we can seek outside of ourselves the connection that is reflective of our origins and destiny, of our desires, to allay our fears. And it's sensible to assume that herein lay a creativity that you would not wish to abuse, that you would not wish to diminish in its incredible stature, in the name of eliminating all fear, all anxiety, all sense of isolation or alienation from the world. It's about proportion. And the loss of proper proportion in the name of nihilism or salvation and so forth is the cause and effect of all violence. It's disproportionate insults to human intelligence, disproportionate gambits for total freedom, total security, total safety, which is something we'll never have and probably don't even need to have. And I would add that to my neo-agnostic philosophy that no one can or even needs to know anything for sure about God or the universe. I'm going to quote, it's kind of an odd reference, but actually in studying an added academic literary criticism of Milton, John Milton's Paradise Lost, the poem, I came upon these words, and they speak to the epic, the truly epic and insoluble issue, paradox, of individual awareness and the primordial source and in a sense desire for reconnection and union of a self that seems vitally born in some kind of dichotomy with its own nature and that of the world around us. But it's not solved by annihilating the self. Right? That leads to a lot of problems. So the quote is like this. This is from Joan Mallory Weber, University of Washington Press, Milton and his Epic Tradition, page 103 to 104, published in 1979. She says, I have been looking at the epic in terms of a number of suppositions that deeply occupy the human mind. This is an epic poem. It's a long poem, and it comes to be of great significance in literature. I have been looking at the epic in terms of a number of suppositions that deeply occupy the human mind. Every epic is built on some basic assumptions about the nature of reality. That consciousness emerges out of an encompassing source, which in varying degrees inhibits, threatens, or nourishes it. That a person cannot be recognizably human unless he differentiates himself from that source. But separation involves awareness of death. epic characters and epic poets have tasks to accomplish within the context of a given society. But the poem is more subversive of its society than has been ordinarily believed. The hero's task is performed, and his society is accepted because there is no other. But it is always clear that neither the culture nor its preservation is as important as self-conflict and self-knowledge. The real task is to accept one's own mortality and then to transcend it, avoiding those elusive havens which seem to offer shelter from a hopeless world. The hero's education through art, through human relationships, and through contemplation teaches him to surpass awareness by means of awareness. Assuming consciousness to be a given and life worthwhile, epic suggests patterns of reconciliation enabling opposites to recover wholeness in one another and life to be affirmed by means of death in a momentary transcendence. And this was used as a quote by me at the beginning of my own version of Paradise Lost, which I will try to link in the description and can be found quite easily at my blog at cosmicheaven.blogspot.ca. We are so widely and completely influenced, quite beyond our knowledge or education, every day of our entire lives. Our most cardinal points of objective and subjective reality so completely deranged that the greatest frontier of human growth is no new land or territory, no epic journey through the reaches of outer space. No. The greatest frontier of human growth is an austere as novel scale of personal responsibility and psychological sovereignty wholly unknown to us for perhaps thousands of years. We, the true people, do solemnly swear to gain control of the psychological and geopolitical infrastructure of the global economic racketeering systems, and so to allay by degrees the narcotic collusion of its mercenaries, apologists, benefactors, beneficiaries, and prey, among whom we count ourselves. We true people will then commence transforming under the surviving power of the native eminent and imminent born coordination of the entire panoply of concentric, celestial, and terrestrial spheres of mass human biological and psychological capital into a fabled paradise. Or go to Rome, which is the sepulcher. Oh, not of him, but of our joy. 'Tis not that ages, empires, and religions there lie buried in the ravage they have wrought. For such as he can lend, they borrow not glory from those who made the world their prey. And he is gathered to the kings of thought who waged contention with their time's decay. And of the past are all that cannot pass away. That is from Adonai, written by Percy Shelley in 1821. It's about 200 years ago. And I will finish with a poem. What I would bury in a kind of time capsule were the world in great danger of being completely destroyed, or at least humanity completely eradicated within a 24-hour period. So should there be some surviving humans a few hundred years, this is what they would find. This is what I consider part of the task of the poet, to commemorate something of kind of a lyrical version of history, the better to stimulate the mind, the very instrument with which we make the most crucial determinations about our place in nature and how to gain or extract or enjoy what is offered in terms of nature's nourishment of our safety, our potential, our infinite potential, as it were, moon and sun and star. Chance and fortune had a brood of hungry children, bayed with all their gods, and heaven were forever racked with doom, who with creation all their ill and whole destruction made. Mark all they left, a germ of wind and rain, a sperm that swam like seed across and borne aloft the sun and moon and seas, all roiling with the warring stories nature and of man, contended for a certain fortune wrought from sure calamities, engrossed the ruler of the mind, a sovereign in her day, a people knew a spirit, beauty, truth, and wonder coursed their every fund, illimitable wonders, mothers may as well prevail upon a child, every wild formed upon the mind, a kind of land imagined and enjoyed, the easy bounds of darkling hounds of stories, God and love. This is a reference. If we imagined a perfect world in the distance, it's easier to do sometimes when you look into the distance on a bright in the daylight, that a world of imagination and wonder would be beset with evils that would there be called religion and spirituality. The easy bounds of darkling hounds of stories, God and love. It would be an easy contention. It'd be easily kept at bay. Presumed to disabuse their heirs and victims were employed as well by science and the spirits, taking minds and blood. The better make a hell a heaven out of hell, insatiable as appetites reduced, excused, ordained, by nothing more than being born, for stories we could spell, much better without being helped by orthodox and blade. Enshrined with lusts that took our blood for all our good and theirs, who suffered from the ignorance and innocence of youth. So man and nature from the substance of forever bears, each spirit of the human mind had find eternal air unfolding truth. And beauty, any god of thought that should command the toil of the angels of the earth, the gods of their own thoughts, disposed, observe like dawn or lunar tides of blood and sap the mortal coil of imagination, law unto itself, the perfect native temple of our homes. And wherever Jesus went, the sword would fall and blood was spent. Muhammad came with much the same. What took your heart would take your brain. I hope you've enjoyed these words, as minuscule my diminutive existence among the throng of the histories and the living forms of all the human beings in the world. Herein is set off, I think, the considerable power of the human voice and its ability to translate, to spell and dispel what man is made of man, and what remains of our original nature, what could be called our original nature, or maybe just the original streams and wind and rain and child and laughter and even our tears of our sovereign land, the sovereign imagination and mind wherein we could embellish stories of our God, our cosmos, our past, our future, our life and our death, and their best to guard that sovereign land. The wonder and the mother of our children, the love of mothers and fathers, boys and girls, man and nature. Our religion were the laughter of our children, and the streams that run there, thereupon the voices, thereupon the free voices of the human race. And for this reason, we would do best to listen to the cries of the world, the cries of every hand that strikes another, of every thought that ignores oneself, and especially in the name of some safety or salvation. Costs borne by our most vulnerable members of society quite beyond their subsequent ability to calculate or even care about, forced as they themselves become to deny themselves, to appeal to the truly monstrous authorities of a system that, like a monster, would eat our children alive. And in many respects, pleasurably so. Each human being then repurposed to run the cogs and wheels of that jaw, that maw, content to play their insignificant, if monumental, parts in stirring, feeding, disturbing, and protecting the strange kinds of visions that have occupied us for far too long, like a drug, condemning us to a disorientation to life far, far greater than is defensible, as somewhat set adrift as I think we all would be and are by birth in the best of worlds. Therein lay the paradox, the threshold of a creative intelligence that I would still argue that properly enjoyed and employed would see far less suffering in the world than we have today. And as often because of the cures as because of the illnesses with which we are beset. Thanks for listening.